Making a documentary is really hard work. Making a bad one is hard enough, and making a good one is incredibly difficult. I would really worry about writing a recipe for a documentary. I would find that quite difficult to do. You see many documentaries where the camera sort of metaphorically sways around, not quite sure where it's looking. But the documentaries that really move me and I think are powerful are where there's a very clear, determined decision to explore a particular idea. I suppose the second thing is that the world is not black and white. The world is very complex, and there are no rights and no particular wrongs, I don't think. What documentary characters should do is to represent those dilemmas, those ethical questions about the way we live, and they should to some extent embody them. And I think we recognize them because we all have those questions in ourselves. So when we see a character on screen who is doing something or thinking something that we think in private, we find enormous release from that, and attraction and empathy and all sorts of things. So my belief about documentary is that it's about telling stories that help us make sense of a complex and difficult world. So we need stories, and by telling stories about life in Eastern Europe and what its ambitions are, what its hopes are, and what the problems are, it helps, I think, communicate to other people who share those problems and those hopes that there is some sort of positive outcome here, that they can understand that someone's telling them a story that they recognize. And I think that helps reinforce ideas about change and what it is to be human and what it is to be part of a community that shares and believes in itself. So I think those stories are really important to us. Not just documentaries, but fiction too. I just happen to love documentaries. I've been so struck by the number of children here. It's really impressive. And I think if you can have your first cinema experience watching a documentary, I think that could be very profound for people, because they've seen maybe on their phones or on their televisions fiction and children's programs and things. But to see a proper documentary in a cinema when you're young, it's potentially a very powerful experience, I think. So I think that's really impressive. I've never seen that anywhere else before in festivals. But I'm conscious, as everyone is, that the world is changing. And even in Britain, public service structures are gradually breaking down under commercial pressure. And at the same time, though, there are these massive American streamers, and people are being able to publish digitally themselves, which was never possible in my day. So students say to me, you know, I really need to go and make a film. Why can't I go and make a film? And I say, you can make a film now. You know, get your phone out, get your software off your free editing software off your laptop, and make a film. And it's what I do. I mean, I made a little 4-minute film a few months ago, cut it myself. I still love doing that. But there's no reason why you can't do that. I think the best filmmakers work because they have this burning need to tell a story. A story about something that matters to them, and they hope that it will matter to other people. And that search for recognition of oneself in a story is what drives that. So I don't think I would equate wanting millions and millions of viewers on YouTube with documentary filmmaking. I think they're different questions. They happen to share the same technology, but they're going in different directions. The world doesn't know what it wants to see or hear. If you start giving the world what it says it wants, you end up in a cul-de-sac. If you listen to what's inside you and what makes you tick, and you want to share that with other people, people will always watch it, I think, because we all recognize that in ourselves. The range of films that we looked at was really broad, actually. About half were to do with communism and the life after communism and people's ability to deal with that. But there were 4 or 5 other films that were about modern Eastern Europe without reference to the past. However, what I would say is that every film, to some extent, is infected with a memory and a history. And I don't think we can escape our history wherever we live. So in some ways, I found the films an education, because I saw inside what had been a communist regime and how people had dealt with that afterwards. But I also saw a more general picture of how life, how people try and build life after something like that, something as traumatic as that. I don't think there's any difference between some of the more impoverished areas of Western Europe and some of the areas that I've seen in Eastern Europe, and particularly in Eastern, in Berlin after the fall of the wall. There was some deep impoverishment, but not vastly different to things I've seen in Scotland or Northern England. Or, you know, obviously I'm glad that Eastern Europe is part of the EU and part of our whole common culture now, rather than being separated. And it diffuses that sense of being afraid of something, both in Eastern Europe afraid of the West and the Western Europe afraid of the East. And I think that's only for the good. So it's just a delight to be able to see a place like this, although I understand it's more wealthy than other parts of Romania, but to see a place like this where people are relatively free. I think there's still undercurrents of control and things going on and corruption, but I'm very moved by how positive people seem to be about and how proud they are of places like Sibiu.